Not any of you all know Latin, but I think that's logical. Two, three.
Okay.
Four.
Okay.
Take a stab at this. Extra ecclesia nulla salus. Any guess? Extra ecclesia nulla salus. Credo in unum diem would be what you're talking about. No, but this is, these Latin words were used for generations to place a false hedge around Christian community. Those words originated with Cyprian, who was the 2nd century bishop of Carthage. And although the meaning behind them is true, they have been twisted in a way that has been very self-serving in the past. Because you see, the church is not a human construct. It's made up of human beings, but it is God's work. And it really can't be fenced. Rome historically interpreted Cyprian's words to mean those in communion with the Pope. Luther referred to those words, saying it was wherever the gospel was preached and the sacraments administered. For Anglicans, there never really was a clear distinction about what the definition of who was in and who was out of the church was, except, of course, when the crown thought it politically expedient. And we all know how that sort of stuff goes. But what if God's solution to the variances of personalities and the styles and preferences of human beings was to allow us to find alternative voices that still speak truth, but through a different mouthpiece? In other words, what if we started to look at Christianity not as a series of camps, but rather as the unity of the baptized? Now, Christianity, though, has always had camps. I mean, because Judaism had camps. We come out of this tradition of who is in and who is out. There were Pharisees and there were Sadducees. There were Essenes and there were Zealots. Judaizers and Gentile converts. Going into the first 1,000 years of the church, we have Roman Catholicism separating from Eastern Orthodoxy. And then, of course, in the Reformation, we've got the Church of England and the Nonconformists. Nowadays, if we look at our Lutheran brothers and sisters, we see that there are 5 major bodies and a whole bunch of other minor bodies. And Anglicanism since the 1970s has been just the same. Baptists, for example, have a congregational polity so that who is and who is not technically a Baptist actually can be disputed even within their own denominations. Many of us are all too aware of the divisions in the ironically named of late United Methodist Church. So some things are age old. And it seems natural to us that the disciples are genuinely worried about who is in and who is out. We have that history. We always, though, like to think that we're the ones that are in and the other people are out, don't we? That's not just human nature. So in the midst of this first century factionalism, Jesus affirms one who is working outside the 12. He orders the disciples to allow this person to continue to work. And I think that's profound. In the 21st century, we get ourselves all ruffled up or even jealous when a church that offers the same message of salvation in a different set of trappings, we perceive as a threat. Why? Go into any community, any. And if there is a growing church, the struggling churches resent them. Could it not simply be an issue of preferences? Means of communicating the exact same message. Perhaps they are not the other as much as we perceive them to be. I know a number of folks that have a faith, solid Christian faith, faith that looks very similar to mine, but English scroll-through ritual like what we do is just not their effort. okay. I personally also felt the emotional pulls of worship of singing a cappella hymns around a campfire with people who belong to denominations that I would never visit on a Sunday morning. Sometimes we forget that the other is often us. As we read on, we find Jesus addressing the hindrance of the other person's ministry as sinful. Do not stop him. Jesus isn't pulling out the guns in order to correct the apostles and say, no, the church's institutional unity is challenged by him. Get him to stop. Nothing like that. He says, let him be. He further gives credence to his ministry, noting that acts of power often have the advantage of evangelization. I remember one such traveling itinerant who asked to speak at one of the churches that I served as rector. He calls me up cold, and while on the phone, I could hear this man's earnestness, and I thought, you know, something's really on fire with this guy. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to let him talk. So I said, sure, you can speak. And he was scheduled for the following Sunday's coffee hour to give a talk. Now, this fellow had no idea who I was. He had no background in the Episcopal Church. And in that moment, all of that was immaterial. He shared a very simple story about being on the fence in his faith. And he prayed out of desperation for his dying sister. In short, the man's faith became like bedrock when shortly after that prayer, doctors phoned him to inform him that his sister had gone into remission. Maybe it was timing. Maybe it was just a moment in time when this man's heart was ready. The one thing I do know is that God used that man, however apart from the institutional church, to do a very powerful and there was a reward. That reward for him is the gift of faith. Jesus goes on, no one who does a deed of power in my name will soon be able to speak against me. Jesus, we need to remember, is ready to answer all prayers. All prayers. For all of us are God's children. And all of us are capable at our best using our lives to acknowledge him, and at our worst, to forget or even reject him. And all of us are a mix of that somewhere. Those who are not against us are for us is a reminder that we cannot dismiss the actions of other persons or church bodies as somehow less spiritual than our own. In fact, you might even make the argument that it runs right up there with the unpardonable sin, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. We do well to remember that God is not impressed with our associations. He is impressed with our earnestness. The story from Esther illustrates just this. She might have been married to King Ahasuerus, but she's got no power. She is able to stop the murderous plans of Haman only because she is authentically concerned and she prays, not just as a person who is in a place of privilege, but a person who prays with humility. If ever there has been a prayer that has been answered, it is the prayer of a humble person before his or her loving God. And she was, for, as Mordecai said, a time just as this. I've long marveled at the way God answers the prayer of people who are truly desperate. When there's no way forward, when there's no life perceptible, when there's no human way possible, men and women of God take their place at the foot of the cross and they find out that indeed God alone is enough, that there is still power in the blood, and there is a balm in Gilead that can soothe the sins. It's often among the fringes of life that the gospel is best proclaimed. And within the institutional church, where the souls of the faithful are often very unmoved before God, as we think we have it all together, and we don't. Now, before you hear me wrong, I'm not all down on the institutional church. We all need canon law. We need our creeds. We need our scriptures. We need our clergy. We need liturgies. But to think that that is the only way in which God works is to confine God on our terms. If we look at the church instead as the invisible unity of the baptized, it's a far better way because it cuts through our jargon, our pride, and even the names on our signs. So have you watched God work? Even outside the institutional church. Let us remember that whoever is not against us is for us. Let us work to be more embracing of the wonderfully divergent ways that men and women act when compelled by the Holy Spirit. Remember that spiritual fruit is born as a testimony of the faithfulness of the one acting. If we pay attention to the one who is bearing fruit, then we might get a little better glimpse of the true life of the Spirit. And the true life of the Spirit is ever growing and ever living in the hearts who have made Jesus the throne in their hearts. So outside the church, there is no salvation. That is true. Yes, but that is not the institution of the church. It's the invisible unity of baptized believers. Despite what is on our signs, and despite whatever quibbles we may have over minor doctrinal issues, Jesus is still telling us, do not stop them. And, in fact, as I have found, they actually might have something pretty profound to teach us. Amen.